Welcome to Clarke House Museum, owned by the City of Chicago, managed by its Department of Cultural Affairs and Special Events, and furnished by the National Society of the Colonial Dames of America in the state of Illinois, known as the Colonial Dames. The Dames have been involved with Clarke House since 1977, when the city purchased it from Bishop Lewis Henry Ford and moved it to its current location. Bishop Ford stipulated its restoration and understood that the Colonial Dames would be involved. So for nearly 50 years, the Dames have funded extensive research, guided its restoration, and staged the interpretation of Clarke House. Throughout the house, you will see authentic period furniture, art, and artifacts set in reproduction historic finishes, which bring the historic building to life for you. The National Society of Colonial Dames of America is a heritage organization with a trifold mission. It actively promotes the understanding of American history through historic preservation. It undertakes patriotic service projects for former and serving military, and it supports a wide range of educational programs. Please enjoy your tour of this beautiful, important building, made possible by the joint efforts of the City of Chicago, the Colonial Dames, and the volunteers who are our hosts.
A house from the 1830s in Chicago seems pretty unusual for a city that was famous for building itself up, tearing itself down, even partially burning down at one point in time. Now, if you talk to somebody out east in New England and you said you had a house from the 1830s, they'd say, oh, you've got one of the new ones. But for Chicago, this is really unusual, and the survival of the house that we're standing in now is really pretty remarkable in terms of all the kind of the highs and lows and the drama of its existence. I'm Tim Samuelson. I'm the cultural historian for the City of Chicago, and I'm here to take you on a tour to see some of the highlights of the architectural features of the house, how people lived at that point in time, and a remarkable story of the ups and downs of a house that somehow has managed to survive until this very day. The story of this goes back to the couple who built it, and this is Henry and Carolyn Clarke. They had a very nice life in the 1820s. In fact, they were married in 1827. They were part of fancy society in New York State. They lived with the finest china and servants, and Mr. Clarke, his father was a prominent attorney. Mrs. Clarke, her family was a physician. They both were well educated. In fact, Carolyn Clarke was quite remarkable. She went to what was an important early school, the Troy Female Seminary, that educated women in professions and educational programs that would be able to deal with life in terms of business and things beyond normal roles of women. So they could have had a nice life in high society with nice food and china and servants back in New York, but where did they decide to go but Chicago, which was basically a glorified mud hole, but a perfectly located mud hole for a country that was growing west, with the Great Lakes connecting to the East Coast through water canals and then later with the railroads. This was the perfect hub where everything would be funneled that would go from the country growing from the East Coast to the West Coast. The city could only grow and thrive. So the Clarke property, it's far away from where most people are settling in Chicago, and it's a pretty remote place. It's a long, narrow strip of land, and you've got Lake Michigan at one side, and so you had cold lake breezes. And then, when Mrs. Clarke finally comes to join her husband in Chicago, the house isn't here yet. The place to live is an existing wood cabin that's on the site. Tiny little house. Can you imagine from going from your fine East Coast place with servants and fine furnishings and society and moving to a log cabin? Welcome to Chicago. But they made fast plans to be able to build a new house. And not just any ordinary house, but a house that was going to show Chicagoans that they had arrived and they were a success in a new place. And unlike the modest little houses in Chicago that most people were living in, this was going to be a model of style, the latest styles and perfection. if you look at the way the house looks here as originally built and see the portico on the front, it'll kind of remind you of a Greek temple. And that's very deliberate because this was a popular style on the East Coast called Greek Revival. And so you would design a house that would be like a little miniature Greek temple. This was an important statement to make because the United States was new, certainly Chicago was new, and people who lived in the United States wanted to kind of affirm themselves and say that we can stand up with the great ancient civilizations. And so an architecture that looked to these ancient classical forms was really a statement. Also, the Clarks really wanted to establish themselves in Chicago business and society. And so by having this kind of very prominent house that was better than most people's houses, that's making a statement about themselves. Houses being built in Chicago were often done with a kind of a new technology they called balloon frame, because heavy timber lumber was hard to come by around here. You could take small pieces of lumber and make a cage of slender lumber members, nail them together with minimal craftsmanship, and make a house. It was kind of like making a balloon of wood and then covering it with a protective cladding of a roof and side walls. Well, not for the Clarks. In fact, there's even a story of Mrs. Clark thinking that these were really flimsy, and how can you trust that? This was going to be built the way you built a good solid house out east. Solid timber frame. It's like building a barn in a way. Big, heavy timber frame, and then you fill in with the wood infills along the way. This was really kind of a remarkable thing to do. It cost a lot of expense, and it took a while to be able to build this house. The house rises up from 1835. It's able to be moved in partially by 1837. In fact, they never fully complete the house. And so on the first floor of the house, they didn't get around to finishing the interiors on the south half of the house, but they did on the north. But it was set up in high style to impress the people that could say, wow, the Clarks are somebody who have really arrived in this frontier, desolate area of Chicago and built a place of a lot of class. It was something all about ambition and in many ways kind of showing off for everybody. As far as evidence of what this house looked like over the years, there's not a lot to document the early times at this house. In fact, we don't even know what the Clarks looked like. No portraits or anything have survived. As far as the house itself, it's basically this image. And the house was about 25 years old at the time it was created. You can see how it's wooded around the house. This was actually something that was added by Mrs. Clark when she finished up the house in the 1850s. It's Italian in style. It doesn't go with the rest of the house. She wanted to keep it stylish. By the 1850s, Greek Revival is so 1830s, but you add this to make it more modern. But take that away visually and you can see what remains of the old Greek Revival, like a little wood Greek temple out in the outskirts of Chicago. So let's imagine it's from the 1830s to the 1850s, the history of the Clark House. Where did the food come from? Came out of the basement of the house. Now, mind you, this house moved three times, and the base of the building was made out of brick. So when it moved, they didn't take the brick with. So in the restoration, we built brick walls, but we had to recreate what was down in that lower level. This is a very compact recreation of what a kitchen would have been like in the house, and it is actually reflecting how the house would have looked when Mrs. Clark finally was able to finish the house in the 1850s. Now, when the house was new in the 1830s, how did you cook? A big open hearth fireplace. And so you'd build a fire. You had a kettle that would be on an armature inside that you'd pull out. You'd be actually cooking around actual fire. I mean, you could set your clothing on fire. In fact, that was a real issue years ago. But this is to show the house modernized to the 1850s. No more of that old-fashioned 1830s cooking on an open hearth fireplace when you have a nice modern iron stove. And it can do many different things. It can heat up the water in a kettle. It can cook your meal. It can actually heat up your irons that you use for ironing clothes. All the modern conveniences. Now, one thing you don't have as far as a modern convenience is any kind of refrigeration. So food has to be mostly things that can be stored for a long time in jars, as you'll see behind me. And so that's beans and seeds and things like that can last for a really, really long time. For water, you don't just turn on the tap like you do in a modern house. There was a water pump out back, and of course, when it got to be winter, that would freeze up. You had a small pump here in the kitchen. You'd have to pump the water that you needed. You could get it to be able to fill your kettle, for example. And of course, another thing too, with having a nice big kettle like this, this comes in handy for another ritual that would be of the time of this house, and that is bath time. And so you had a metal bathtub. Now we have a children's version of it here, which is very small, but there is also would be an adult-sized version. You would fill this with hot water, and there was a protocol of how you bathe that's really kind of, you'll think of it today and go, oh my gosh. The adults would bathe in that water first, and then starting with the oldest child to the youngest child, you'd share the same bath water. Throw the baby away with the bath water. That's where that came from, because by the time poor baby had to bathe in that water, it was so nasty, maybe you couldn't even see the baby was in there. As far as eating meals, the Clarks had servants, and so they would have eaten downstairs in the kitchen, and the table would be set up for them. But in later years, I think the Clarks, with their large family, would have actually eaten down here as well. The upstairs was more reserved for formal dinner parties and guests. But for kind of more informal dining amongst the family, it wouldn't be unusual for them to eat down here as well. There's other aspects in here of things that are kind of forgotten technologies of kitchens long ago. One of my personal favorites is this kind of unusual beehive-shaped thing that's white behind a glass dome. We ask people what it is when they come here, and they say, I don't know. That's how you got sugar in those days. That was called a sugar loaf, and you had to keep it under a glass dome to protect it. And then to get some sugar, you'd take little pinchers, and you'd pinch some off, put it in the mortar and pestle, break it into small granules, and then you would have your sugar. It was a very different way of living, very different way of eating, very different way of bathing back in that period of the 1830s to the 1850s, and it's all right here. We're standing at the main entrance of the Clarke House. This is the view that visitors would see when entering the house for the first time. The view would be straight east out to Lake Michigan on its original site. Typical of a Greek Revival house is this long central corridor. Things are very symmetrical. You have a identical doorway at both sides. This long corridor allowed you to be able to open up the doors at both sides and get wonderful cross breezes that would circulate through the entire house. The detailing of this house is very typical of a Greek Revival house. This, of course, was part of the original construction of the house in the 1830s, this wonderful fluted woodwork. And to make those corner blocks, they actually cut a piece of that into triangles and put them together to create that square at the corner. They took pine doors, finished them to look like cherry. Everything about this is to impress. Also, the nice hardwood of the staircase going right upstairs. And of course, you have a house that's a little wood Greek temple. And what wood Greek temple is complete without some fake wallpaper, marble wallpaper? And it's actually made in such a way that instead of typical wallpaper that goes put up like this, the wallpaper goes like this. This is the seam right here. All meant to impress and a model of what you would see in a Greek Revival house. We're now in one of the principal rooms of the first floor of the house. Now keep in mind, when the house was first built, the north half of the house on the first floor was completely finished. This was the living spaces. The south half of it was left just raw timber and unfinished, and it didn't get finished for a long time. But this room had probably many different identities over the course of the house's history. But this is restored that you can see a lot of the features of a classic Greek Revival interior. Look at the tallness of the windows here to get much needed natural light and ventilation into the house. The sills almost go all the way down to the floor. The wallpaper is based on a pattern that was actually discovered hidden under some wood moldings that would date from the earliest incarnations of the house, and it's reproduced here. The carpet is what you'd call ingrain carpet, very fashionable. It has a pattern. It was actually woven in long strips and sewn together. What'd you use for heat in this house? Here it is right here, a fireplace, and you can see the size of the hearth on this. And this is how you would keep warm in the wintertime. And one of the leading causes of injury and even death back at the time of this house was people's clothes catching on fire, getting too close to the fireplace. In fact, Henry Clarke actually was involved with the fire brigade at one time. You had to have next to the fireplace a bucket of sand that if suddenly the fire got out of hand, you could use that as your fire extinguisher. We're now standing in the front parlor, and you can see all of the classic Greek Revival details, like the woodwork of the fireplace and also the surrounds of the windows. The great, of course, part of the original house with the windows that go almost down to the floor. Now, people will often talk about living room and dining room, the way we think of rooms today. This house, particularly because they only were occupying and finished the north half of the house, they had to improvise and flexible about what rooms were used for. And over the evolution of the time that the Clarks lived here, there was an evolution of what the furniture was and what was where. But it had to be versatile. And in furnishing the house, and many of the original antique pieces that the colonial dames gathered for display here, I think the one that really demonstrates the idea of versatile furniture is what seems like a regular rocking chair. But if you have a baby, you can pull this out, pull this off of there, put it in there, and you have a perfect little cradle to rock the baby. This is not unusual to have this kind of versatile furniture in houses of this era, where you really have to creatively adapt the house to what spaces you have available to you. We're now on the second floor, the main corridor. Now, like you had on the first floor in a Greek Revival house, you have a corridor going through the house, but it doesn't go all the way to the ends of the house. There are closets at each end. This would be for storage of your travel trunks, hat boxes. Maybe you have a child's cradle and you're in between children. You need to have a place to store it. So those would be on each end of the house. But you don't have the natural light flooding in here like you had on the first floor. It'd be even darker if it wasn't for the fact of when Mrs. Clarke finished the house in the 1850s, she put a cupola on the top of the house. The natural light can spill in and come down here to the corridor. If that wasn't there, it would be really, really dark in here. Now, there's a special bonus with watching this kind of a tour in that going up in that cupola, which is glass, it's all was designed on the outside in the Italianate style. We don't normally let visitors go up there because the stairs are kind of narrow and a little bit treacherous. But in this special opportunity, we're letting the cameras upstairs and you will get a view of what it's like from the very top. This is the largest room on the second floor, and most likely it was Mr. and Mrs. Clark's bedchamber. A large, expansive space. It has special features in it that would have accommodated living at that particular time. This is a bed of that era. You can see the drapes on the top of it. That's not just for decoration. That's to close it off. One, you can conserve heat with it, but also it could keep out bugs. For storing your clothes, you didn't have dedicated closets. You had wardrobes and also a chest of drawers that you would have for smaller linens and articles of clothing The one that we have here has a large square drawer at the top. That's where you would put a hat. So you could put a whole hat in there and it wouldn't crush it. Now you want to keep things looking nice in the master bedroom. This looks like an ordinary two-drawer chest, but wait, it has another function. Instead of a drawer, it lifts up like this. You lift up the bottom, and you have a convenient place to put the chamber pot for late-night emergencies. To illustrate the way the house is built with that old traditional New England post and beam construction, also the idea of split lath construction for putting on plaster, a section of the wall has actually been left open that you can actually see it from the inside. And you can see how what would be flat plaster on the one side in the corner is oozing out and then sets up, and that's what keyed it into the wall. In doing the architectural forensics on the house, we learned many things, and one was that this doorway leading into the master bedroom wasn't here when the house was first built, but it was added very soon after. And I think the probable reason for that is the Clarks had many children, this being the parents' bedroom, that they could hear, if this is the place you had a baby, to hear the baby cry or a children stirring, it could come to the attention of the parents. Also, the main heat of this second floor is that stove in the master bedroom. That heat would migrate in and help keep this room nice and warm. Now the bed itself, it's kind of very different from the way you think of beds today and how they're made. There's a similarity, but the materials and the technologies are very different. The bedspread, now this may look like something that's brand new, but it's probably about 160 and 170 years old. It's woven on a loom, the Jacquard loom, to create these patterns. And these are so durable. And the ones that survive, people actually use them to this very day in modern times if they still have them. And they are so nice and warm. But it especially was welcome back in 1830s, 1840s, 1850s. When central heat was non-existent, you needed every bit of heat that you could. This is your mattress. And it is basically a giant pillow. And so it's basically sewn together two pieces of cloth. In the middle of it are feathers. And again, feathers were a commodity that certainly was available. So how you maintain a mattress, I guess, and you can see it gets a little lumpy, and so you want to have a nice flat area to be able to rest on. And so you have this here, which when I have to give tours and I say, what is this for? And they said, for the children. I said, no, this is for flattening out the feathers in this mattress to get it nice and uniform and flat. And if you do it right, you can redistribute those lumps of feathers so that it makes a nice flat surface. There, I didn't do that too badly. And then pulling this up, now you have a box spring for a bed. That didn't exist in those days. So you have instead ropes. And this is what's known as a rope bed. So to have a comfortable sleep, these need to be really taut. In fact, these really need some attention here. So when these ropes would stretch out from people using it over time, you need to tighten them up. And so you find a point of contact where it's knotted. See, it's on little pegs here. This is a key for tightening those ropes. You put this around the ropes, and you start to twist it around and around and get it to make that absolutely tight. Because it's really important to get a good sleep that this be absolutely flat and taut. Otherwise, you're sleeping in a well. And it's a sign of good hospitality to have a bed offered where the ropes are tight. And that is the origin of the expression sleep tight, because that means sleeping on tightened ropes on a rope bed, but that term is still used today. We're standing now in one of the small bedrooms at the back of the house on the second floor. This room is furnished with a rope bed and a chest of drawers similar to what you would have in the period of the house. We also know a lot about this room because in the later era of the Clarke's residency here, they actually took in a boarder. Alice Bernard was a Chicago public school teacher who was then later promoted to be the first woman to hold the position of principal in the Chicago public schools. This was her room. In fact, we know it because she kept the diary and told about what it was like living here. And part of her tenure here was in a difficult time when the Clarks were having financial difficulty after the big financial collapse of 1837. So having a boarder here certainly helped with the finances. This is also an era where the rooms immediately below us had not been finished yet in the 1830s, 1840s. And this is where Henry Clarke was doing hunting, gutting deer, hanging them out to dry in the interior room. And Alice Bernard mentioned in her diary the smell of those carcasses wafting up into this room. Not pleasant. 1835, 1836. One of the terrors of life in that era was waterborne disease. Chicago has a cholera epidemic. Who contracts fatal cholera but Henry Clarke? And he dies. So now who is responsible for this unfinished house out on the outskirts of the city of Chicago, fighting off the creditors? Carolyn Clarke. But remember, Carolyn Clarke had training in business practice. And she then suddenly realizes, kind of a fortuitous coincidence, she's responsible for this house and her family. The city has now caught up to where the house is. What was 20 acres of, you know, desolate land now has the potential to be fine residential property. It's near the lake, it's close to the central business district of Chicago, yet far enough away that you're away from the noise and the congestion and the hustle bustle. So under Carolyn Clarke's supervision, streets are put through, lots are subdivided, sells off 18 of the 20 acres, and actually makes money in the 1850s. She saves the day. And rather than struggling, she now has money and she's able to achieve something that she, you know, that she had hoped for years, finish the house. So now you have the north half of the house, 1830s, Greek Revival high style. By the 1850s, oh, Greek Revival, that's so out of date. And so Carolyn Clarke gets to do it in the newest style, Italian it. How did it look? What did she do? Let's step in and take a look. This is reflective of the new modern style, the Italian it. Very different than what you saw on the other side of the house. None of that fussy wallpaper. The walls are painted bright, solid colors. Just maybe a decorative trim here and there. The woodwork, instead of the fluted detailing with the little corner blocks, it is a more complex mill design that was available at that particular point in time and reflects a different way of expressing the windows. Also, the furnishings of the drapes and furnishings all reflect a different era. In keeping with it being the Italian it, you have a fireplace, which still is providing heat for the house. And what Italian house is complete without Italian marble on the facing? But that is actually fake Italian marble. It is painted wood by craftspeople who are really good at imitating Italian marble with little brushes and feathers. A real Italian marble was hard to come by these days. The use of the rooms was flexible. This is set up in here as a dining room. The other parlor is set up as a reception room with a piano and things that would kind of show the stature and the education of the occupants. These are sliding doors that can divide this into two separate rooms if you need to be able to do that. It's all about flexibility. Another innovation, no more oil lamps or candles. Unless you want to do that for decorative purposes, you now have gaslight. In the center of the ceiling are ornamental plaster escutcheons painted in many bright colors, similar to the bright colors that you see as the environment of the entire room. It not only creates a bold decorative effect in the center of the room, but gas light in that era was very dirty and it smoked. And if you had that kind of a complex paint job on it, you would not be able to see the smoke as much. The fact that you have two different eras, 20 years apart on each side of the house, is part of the complex story and ironies of this house's history. The house stayed in the Clarke family until 1872. The children had grown up, Mrs. Clarke had passed away since 1860, and the purchasers were a family that was John and Lydia Crimes. John Crimes was an English-born commercial tailor, but here it's sitting in what is now a highly expensive and desirable piece of land, and here is this old 1830s house on it. So what do? They literally take the house and put it on rollers. They move it from its original location around 17th and Michigan and roll it far, far away to 45th and Wabash. Remodel it more in kind of a Victorian style. In fact, here's a view of the house at the time that they lived there, and some of the family in the cart out in front. The family hung on to the house through three generations, and finally in the 1930s, the two granddaughters tried to sell the house to the city for display at the Chicago's World's Fair in 1933. They didn't want it. They looked for a buyer who would appreciate the house and take care of it. They couldn't sell it. The house was falling into disrepair. They couldn't afford to maintain it. The house was starting to rot. What's going to happen to it? Well, it's the early 1940s. Looks like it's all over for the Clarke House. But no, guess again. Who rides to the rescue? Reverend Lewis Henry Ford of the St. Paul's Church of God in Christ, nearby at 45th and Wabash. He convinces the Walter sisters he not only will buy the house, but he will love the house and restore it beautifully. And how does he choose to restore it? In a most unusual way. What better way to showcase the building talents in Bronzeville, the plumbers, the painters, the carpenters, than to have them work on this highly visible house? They do. They restore the house beautifully. It's the first historic preservation project in Chicago. Big signs were put on the house saying the plumbing is done by this African-American contractor, a student of Tuskegee, the painting by this person. And so it becomes a showcase of what talent is available in Bronzeville. And then when the house was finished, Reverend Ford makes an amazing pronouncement saying, we didn't just restore this for the St. Paul Church of God in Christ. We restored Chicago's oldest house so that it is everybody's house in Chicago. The door is always open for anybody who wants to come visit this amazing bit of surviving history. The house then functions amazingly. In fact, I'd say one of the golden ages of the house is when it was with the St. Paul Church of God in Christ. So I can even remember coming into the house at that time. And you might have gospel choir practicing in one room, community center in another. At one point, Reverend Ford and his family lived in the house. And you would be a place of cheer and kids running up and down the staircases. There's even an instance where they briefly had a small soul food restaurant in the basement of the house. How cool is that? But there are changes that also happen by the time you're getting into the 1970s and 80s. The tragedies of urban renewal displaced a lot of people out of Bronzeville. Houses were torn down. The people who were attending St. Paul's, they still wanted to come to church. Bishop Ford was going to stay right there around 45th and Wabash neighborhood. So people are now driving into church. Where are they going to park their cars? So this is a real problem. A novel idea is hatched. The city is looking into the celebration of the American Bicentennial and different celebrations. A park is being put up on Prairie Avenue, which by coincidence is very close to the original site of the Clarke House. What if the city of Chicago buys the house, moves it back that 3.5 miles close to where it originally was, and then be able to open it to the public. And that's exactly what they did. Now, moving it to that 3.5 miles, this is the second time the house is going to move, isn't that easy. You have to move light poles and things that are in the way, power lines, and the tracks of the CTA elevated are right in the way. Well, you use the technology, you lift the house up, slide it across the tracks. It actually froze there briefly, but they got it going again. The house is lowered onto a new foundation. The house is restored to an interpretation the way the house looked when Mrs. Clarke finished the house in the 1850s. The operation of the house is assumed by the National Society of the Colonial Dames of America in the state of Illinois, who furnish it with period furnishings. It is now open to the public, furnished in context. It's here for anyone to come visit. When and how? Just check our website. It's all there for you.